Times form.
Yeah, so.
Explain the SPCA, why they can't do those kinds of.
So the SPCA are engineered for dogs and cats. So Princess Penelope here, it was the Eisenhower she was smuggled on. So there are animals like this, so the exotic pet trade is a cash, primarily cash only business. People think I want to be a breeder, they get two ball pythons and they overflood the market. There are hundreds of them. Exotic pets only represent 10 to 15% of all pets in pet households, but the regulation is a joke. So the SPCAs, especially that are anchored where animal control is, has to take these animals in. Most of the time they're found through drug busts, through other things that are illegal and disreputable, hoarding cases, and then these animals all come to light. It's not like a big dog or an elephant hiding in your backyard. They're very, you can put 100 snakes in a closet, so they're very easy to hide. So when we get calls from the SPCAs, like recently we have Tony Valentine, a 5-foot green iguana, because he was this big and cute when he was bought at an expo. And he is only 5 years old. He'll grow another foot and be about 6 feet long.
So how big is he now?
He's 5 foot now. He's almost full grown. So we had to really find a beta test when I was working with animal control. I live in Newport News, and I was working with Peninsula Regional, and I had alligators in my garage. Every summer, someone has gotten an alligator at an expo, goodness knows when, and then they get too big and can't hide it anymore. So alligators are indigenous to the state of Virginia. Even if they're captive bred, they're illegal to have. So then somebody lets them loose, and because they've been trained and conditioned, that they walk up to the first person and they're looking for a chicken wing. So I had two juvenile 2-foot iguanas and a horse trough in my garage, and my husband came home one night and went, there's two alligators in our garage? And I went, yeah, I told you I was gonna go to Peninsula and I had to pick up some animals. He's like, I think my point is there are two alligators in our garage. So that, in case you're curious, is the husband cutoff. That's when climates, the exotic rescue that kind of happenstanced out of the Gaboon issue started. So that's why we have the shelter that we have now. Yes, Ed?
So your business model is, I guess, your nonprofit, is that?
Yep. We're a state and federal 501c3. We also are doing this above board. So we're doing everything out in the open. We have every city, state, permit. We work with USDA, Department of Inland Game and Fisheries, U.S. Fish and Wildlife, and we work sometimes with the EPA and other agencies where exotic animals have been set free into the wild. And in the case like Florida, Burmese pythons can survive in their ecosystem and have become a problem, and people are just releasing them. So it's very popular amongst the disreputable crowd. So we had gotten a call from outside of Manassas. They had found an 18-foot Burmese python in a meth house and didn't know what to do with it. And I'm a little short, pudgy woman. And to rescue a snake that's been well fed, you need a Rubbermaid tote. And once she's in the Rubbermaid tote, you need a refrigerator dolly. So there are SWAT guys everywhere with a little hair and a custom fit vest. And I plop up with my tote, pick her up, stick her in the tote. We then condition these animals. So if they're legal to have in homes and we feel as zookeepers, chinchillas, ferrets, bunnies, there's rats, there's the small hamsters, guinea pigs. They're small companion animals that don't have these insane lifespans. African spur tortoise is very popular in the pet trade. They are the largest continental species of tortoise and grow to be 300 pounds and live for 300 years. So those we condition and those go to zoos. So Tony Valentine, the 5-foot green iguana we have now, will get trained by the college interns that we have, a lot of which are from ODU. And we have 11 intern postings at every university from William & Mary through NC State. We never really wanted to have a bunch of paid staff, and currently we don't have any paid employees. It's all interns and those who volunteer their time. I've also signed a commitment pledge myself as a director, which is unfortunately where the high dollar value goes in those senior administrative staff. A lot of times they've forgotten what it was like in the beginning. So that all the money goes to the next generation of zoologists, I will never accept more than minimum wage as a salary, ever.
How do you condition a python?
So it's just handling. So the reptiles aren't the same as Junior, who is sacked out. And he's a baby, so he sacks out a lot. They just get used to human interaction. And that myth of a big snake in Africa eating a human is complete myth. I have lived throughout Africa my entire life, from Kenya all the way down to Botswana, Tanzania, South Africa, the Zulu Natal. And a human head is too large for any species of snake to swallow. It's one of those things that you tell your kids so that you don't go outside after dark. Yes, sir?
I'm curious, just a quick follow-up. What was the disposition of the two alligators from your garage?
Well, they were babies. They were great.
Where did they end up?
Oh, they ended up at Alligator Cove. It's a facility in Florida. A lot of our stuff, so the 18-foot berm is at the Houston Zoo. The Maryland Zoo picked up all of our tarantulas. All the animals, no matter how. So that was another festive story. We got a call from one of the neighbors of our board members. So she was tragically afraid of spiders. Divorce. So she's homesick one day, and her son, to disguise the fact there had been a light on in his closet, these things need very specialized care, had been leaving the room to the light on in his room when he was going to school every day. And she was sick home one day, she did laundry, put it on his bed, turned off the light, and his closet glowed. She thought, oh my goodness, my son is growing pot in his closet. Opened up the door and found what we named Fluffy. So she was a Goliath tarantula. That's the most aggressive and largest species of tarantula, called a bird-eating spider. They get to be about the size of a plate. So myself and my assistant went up and we went and picked Fluffy up. She sat and stared with her hands up on the travel container the entire way back. They're highly aggressive. So she was a part of the tarantula that we conditioned that went to the Maryland Zoo. Yes, dear.
Can you say more about the art? To kind of flip past that spot.
Oh yeah, so let me, you ready to run? So the artwork is originally done in Haifa. So the artwork is originally done, I'm making the water really happy, by the animals. And all the things that we do are all artisan handmade. So these we call sustainable swag. Our family volunteers, and we are the only facility that takes volunteers age 1 to 100. This is hand-painted, I'll start at the back. This is hand-painted snake shed. It's painted with food coloring that the children of the family volunteers paint. And then I show the parents how to seal it in surfboard acrylic. So we have keychains, refrigerator magnets, everything. So the animal paintings start out as this. This and each painting has the artist's name on it. So this is Ernest, he's a Greek tortoise. And because we only do things humanely, they take a little while to make. That, especially with the tortoises that are small, to make a larger painting takes some time. But they just think they're walking through mud. They have no idea it's paint. And it's child non-toxic. We even thin it down and add a component of a cellulose so you can even eat it. And I've tested everything. Then, there hasn't been one monkey biscuit or primate chow I haven't tested. And then we have different people who help us. So this is also a tortoise painting. This is Griddle. He's an African pancake tortoise. So sometimes we then have artists add little phrases to them. And this is a little tortoise phrase because Griddle's a tortoise. But it still has his name, and thank you for donating for my artwork, Griddle on the back. We have large artwork. So Ernest and Dude, who are ones of Gulf, that's the two boys in the corner. Ernest is in the front, and then Dude's in the back. So we have large artwork. It takes an entire summer to complete a large piece of art with a smaller animal. And we only do things humanely. I train Junior, he's recall trained, but he's a baby, so he kind of gets distracted. But we don't want to do anything that stresses any of the animals out. That's why before they get adopted, my joke is, an animal isn't adopted or transferred to a facility until it can sit and watch television with you. So when we do these outreaches, we take the animals with us, and they get used to, in a controlled educational environment, being touched by people. If you get it for your kid, your grandkid, they don't live in a bubble. They have friends, and their friends want to play with the animals as well. So that way, they're used to being touched by all kinds of children. But yeah, the artwork we love. I especially love these. And inside of these jars and inside of the smaller boutique items, the animal whose snake shed or reptile shed this is from is also done this painting. So it's got the name. Oh, this is Isabel. That's the 18-foot albino Burmese python. Yes.
So your income streams are through adoption, yep, through the yard. How about grants?
So we're just starting to go after grants, but a lot of them don't really fit us because we have unusual needs. Any grant we would go after, pretty much the wildlife rehabbers, and we do wildlife rehab as well. So we've started going after small grants, but I need people in the community who write grants to donate their time so we can professionally go after larger grants. What we're looking for now are trustee donors. One of the problems that we have is if you come out to the facility, we've made it look too easy because it was always my goal to integrate small boutiques into a retail environment. So everything is pristinely cleaned by interns, 100% from floor to ceiling every day. What zoos do, so if you follow the AZA guidelines, what zoos do once a year, we do once a quarter. What they do once a quarter, we do once a month. What they do once a month, we do once a week. What they do once a week, we do daily. So we've made it look too easy for donors, large donors. And we've also found one of the problems with big donors is when people say they're gonna donate, you get the same norepinephrine rush as when you say you're gonna donate as actually donating. So we've had a lot of people over the span of the 4 years that we've been doing this say, I wanna help, I wanna donate, and they just go to the wind. We get their card, we call them back repeatedly, but I'm not gonna harass people. I'm not going to send you emails over and over and over. I, at the very least, want you to think we weren't gonna try and pressure you into donating. That's why with this beta test, people get to see what it's really like behind the scenes of a zoo. Our entire facility looks exactly like behind the scenes of a zoo does. So you can see the keeper's work. Anything else? We need money?
Well, so Junior's been wandering around,
yep,
for a little while this morning already. If it was my rabbit, she would have found something to chew on, some wires to chew,
yep,
on. Is that common for rabbits?
And yeah, so we condition them to not chew.
How do
but
you condition?
If you, it's just your target training. And it really depends on breed, how much intensity the target training has to be. And we only use operant or positive reinforcement conditioning. We don't ever use no, the bad dog voice, the traditional rolling of the newspaper, no squirt bottles. So if their lives are enriched, then they don't care to chew on things that they don't, that they shouldn't chew. But if you have, and I've done work with people who already have animals, and if all else fails, if you have a chewer and they just fixate on something, you just cut a small section of PVC and slip it over the cord. It's no problem. Do you have a chewer? Yeah, come on out. I'll show you all of the tricks. Because Junior's so tall, so Junior's 3.5 feet long, he can stand to be almost 3 feet, that he can chew stuff that normal bunnies can't get to. So, but it's just enrichment. We show the kids how to make free toys for their animals out of toilet rolls and cardboard boxes. Junior's a herbivore. So if you take a toilet roll and you put a drop of vanilla extract inside and then seal up the ends like a little package, he'll spend hours ripping it apart and he won't go after a cord that doesn't taste like something that he doesn't care about. And he sleeps a lot. He's probably asleep right now. Yes?
Do you have a lot of volunteer veterinarians that work for your group?
No, that's another huge problem. So finding exotic veterinarians is very difficult. They are high dollar appointments. The wildlife rescue stuff gets seen for free. I've gotten some donations and some time for veterinarians, but it's been from cases that they brought to us, that I need the salary for a veterinary. That's one of our number one things, is getting a senior staff that has salaries that can supervise. So I'm our maintenance guy, our administrator, our volunteer coordinator, and what else do I do? I've worked 20-hour days for 4 years, but I'm a little hyper, so that we always have the best foot forward. Yes, you're in the back.
I have a question. I've worked with an exotic animal rescue out of Chesapeake. Mm-hmm. Are you associated with them? Or
what's
you
their name?
Entities? It escaped me. I'm sorry.
So there are breed and species-specific rescues all over the United States. They only take certain things. Most of the ones we work with are Viper in Newport News, that's obviously a reptile. We just started working with REV, Reptile Educators of Virginia, but there's Chinchilla Whimsy, there's Ferret Haven. I've been trying to get them all to group together to have a larger voice in Congress. People listen when you bring a 25-pound bunny anywhere. He's got a little tie, and he was asked to be in the St. Patrick's Day Parade. People lose their mind over him. When you touch him, they go, oh, his fur's so soft. Because it's baby fur, he's still a baby. It's hard for adults, because I do a lot of kids' classes. It's hard for them to realize he's literally got another year to grow. He's, until recently, the only one of his kind in the United States at all, breed-wise at all. Just this last quarter, and he goes to a vet every quarter. He grew 8 inches this quarter. And he's 2.5 now. His birthday is Veterans Day. In England, we call it Armistice Day, which was what my father's birthday was. That's how Junior got donated to us. When his lordship passed, it was in the paper, and my father looked like Tom Selleck and acted like John Cleese and was a widower, so he was very popular amongst the ladies. And Annette donated Junior in memory of my father. That's why he's Junior. He's named after my dad, not his dad.
So you have this facility, mm-hmm. and is it a place where you want people to come to see these animals?
Yep.
And then you said something about birthday parties.
People can come to the facility.
What's the bus?
So the beast is out the back if you guys want to see it. Junior doesn't travel light. So that is a 38-foot repurposed vehicle. There isn't anything that we don't do that doesn't have reduce, reuse, recycle, repurpose in mind. One of the things about being raised in a very remote area is I could probably make a cell phone out of a paperclip and chewing gum. The kids go, yeah, Africa, Africa. So all those baby boomer morals of working hard and doing things correctly, coupled with the millennials of technology. We utilize iRobot at the facility, so things are easier. We get things that are a modern twist to be able to keep things clean. The Beast is out back, and it is a 38-foot mobile outreach unit. I can drag an entire zoo. It's got two canopies. One's 15, one's 18 feet. I have an 18 or a 15-foot classroom. We can bolt onto the side that we can control the climate. There isn't an environment we can't bring an animal or a group of animals to be able to present exotics to the public in regards to the ones that are all redone. This is PetSmart the other day. This is Naomi. This is a chameleon. She's a veiled chameleon. And that is a one-year-old little girl and mom. So that was Naomi's first outreach trip. Once you do on-site touching and the animals get used to it, you then have to replicate that same training at an outreach environment because the components are all so different. And Naomi was a little annoyed at first, but after a little while, she got really into the game. And Naomi will probably be available for adoption in about another week. She's been doing really well. And birthday parties and Yes, sir.
The tarantulas.
Yeah.
Won't let go that way.
Do you, so does
it had to, Bill.
The Maryland Zoo, did they buy them from you or do they donate
money
back to you?
So we do facility transfers. So because these things need to get into facilities, that we pretty much waive most facility fees if we have a excess of something. And it's not like a lot of people like tarantulas as pets. So we don't get them in a great deal, but when we get them in, we get the weird of the weird. That was one of the Junior's pilot article was on the back. We are going to be going to Coast Live once a month. Junior is getting a commendation from the mayor of Virginia Beach. He's the official Easter bunny. I even brought his pledge that we're running for Easter. He's trying to ask you to pledge to never get live animals, especially for Easter, but for any holiday, and sign up to be able to join his chocolate bunny pledge. Submit a chocolate recipe, and we have food bloggers that are going to do them so that we can promote chocolate bunnies and Easter bags, Easter baskets, and not live bunnies. But there's puppies and kittens on Christmas. It's a big problem. I'm already starting to take donations for the surplus of bunnies I'm going to get 3 months to the day after Easter. Last year it was ducks and bunnies. Year before it was chickens and bunnies. Year before that we got a swan and a bunch of bunnies. You can even get chicks at Ace Hardware now. It's not just Tractor Supply. And the suburban coop movement is so big that people go, oh, look how cute, and then don't realize chickens poop a lot. If you don't want to get up at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, you have to get an automatic coop opener. I have a coop at my house. It gets so hot here that you have to have, my chickens have a fan system that we put a block of ice in front of. But I've had suburban coops that when we inspect there's a home visit for every animal, and we set everything up for you. So our chickens after last Easter went to a private home in Pennsylvania that had a barn lifted up off the ground so that a solid floor, and they have HVAC, they have window units there, central heat and air. But the zoos we pretty much waive. Because those are things that can't go anyplace else. We feel, even though it's your right as an American to own a tiger if you want, our animal acquisitions manager, if you have $2,500 in 2 weeks, can get you a bottle-fed tiger cub on the black market. 2 weeks. They're not Bengals, they're not Sumatrans, they're tigers. People who have a tiger here and a tiger there are illegally breeding them together, so that causes Down syndrome, horrible side effects, let alone the Liger, La Liger, Tegon, that movement, founded by a crazy German guy in, I think, Southern California, that has presented its own problems. Much like the Burmese python that we had rescued that went to the Houston Zoo. So they're all caught, they're all been bred, line bred from one wild-caught Burmese python that was found in 1972. So they all have respiratory issues, skin issues. They're line breeding, and it's insane. Yes, sir?
So I have a question for you. The animals that you're donating to somebody, obviously they're valuable animals because they're exotic.
Mm-hmm.
Can you get a taxable write-off on that, like fair market value, and then sell that write-off to them?
Because transfers to
zoos. There's a revenue stream from people looking for a tax strategy.
Right, like Penelope is, so in regards to complete actual value, Penelope. Princess Penelope in the upper left-hand corner is a wild-caught rhino rat snake. The only people we've had apply for her are breeders. It's not a very popular snake in the pet trade because you can't morph its coloration. That's the normal thing we get. Our ball pythons that people are line breeding. Someone found one with a little white speck a couple years ago. So now there's high white. It's like crazy weed stoner names. It's like hetero, you know, purple haze and stuff. We get a lot of the balls, and they have horrible issues if they survive. I've seen hatchlings bite themselves to death, born with no scales, no spines. That for the trade-off for zoos, it's kind of like an internal transfer. But Penelope, in theory, is worth, if you could find her in the United States, $3,000. But in regards to her replacement value, she's worth about $18,000. Because she represents a whole brand new untainted gene pool that a breeder could infuse into their line. And in fact, most of the people who breed rhino rat snakes haven't been able to have very many viable offspring because there are so few of them in the United States. The gene pool is so small that most of them have a neurological issue called nystagmus. We call it ratcheting. Their head just ratchets and ratchets and ratchets and ratchets. So they're euthanized. Some of them are born without spines. Penelope's wild caught and about as mellow as a Cocker Spaniel. So her temperament isn't innate, but the breeders would hope it was. So something like her, she'll probably be with us for a long time. If someone surrendered another one, we'd condition that. We never even had to condition Penelope. We just had to get her health up, and she's been a Cocker Spaniel every day since then.
How big of a Cocker Spaniel
is she? So most snakes aren't very large, like the berms, the anacondas, they get big, the females get very big. But she's a rhino rat, so she's about 5 feet long, but she's only about this
big.
So
we're not looking at
No, she just wraps a plan. I show her to the kids, she wraps around my hand, because she's arboreal, that you hold my, I hold my hand up, and she stretches her neck out. If you'll notice, her head is very distinct, that it looks like a leaf. So she's from the Vietnam rainforest, very densely populated. They have no idea how many there are in the wild. There could be two, there could be 2 million. It's not a safe place to do any research, and deforestation is becoming an issue. She also has special adaptations, like the footballer. This is a black stripe on her face. It's to help her with any sun that breaks through the canopy, to keep the sun out of her eyes, because snakes don't have eyelids, they have eye caps. So she, to us, represents, we could have one snake, and we could do any program topic. And I do infotainment. Everything's real upbeat, positive. I change the semantics and the verbiage to the audience. You guys are all adults. But I've taught children zygodidactyl. It's independent feet, like owls have zygodidactyl feet. And, but Penelope, I could do any program topic. Rainforest, deforestation, reduce, reuse, recycle. Life changes throughout. So when she's little, she's blue. They live in the water. As they get older, they turn green. So for her, we're asking about $11,000. But most of the animals, it's like $100.
You said wild caught. How, what's the story on Penelope? I mean,
so she's in the pilot article. So it was one of those 7 degrees of separation stories. So I'm retired military. I had cancer a couple of times. So after the last time, I went, I'm done. So I was volunteering my time at Portsmouth Naval Medical, and I'm in the lab. So we had first started this, and we were just going to have a small group of pets that we all had, and we were going to then go, okay, we'll do some educational programming with our animals. So when the Gaboon issue happened, we realized we were going to have to deal a little bit bigger. So a young man who apparently worked down the hall for me at Portsmouth Naval Medical was originally enlisted, and one of his sailors had taken Penelope from the wild, put her in his pants, and snuck her shipboard, stuck her in his footlocker. So the Navy really doesn't deal with customs, and he was what we call a herp head. Those people who have an entire room, like I had in my house long before I started doing this, that I had custom-built terrariums that I'd built with live plants, that I had a couple of snakes. When you work at a zoo, the cast-offs are kind of weird. Like, I had a camel when I was at the Nashville Zoo, because she'd been deprived of oxygen in the birth canal, so she was kind of special needs. She needed a helmet. So Kamala, because I lived in the country, Kamala came to live with me until she passed. But, so she was near dead. The young man rescued her. And then that was the pet that he and his girlfriend, now wife, so then his family, human family, grew, and they were at their last child, their third child. We're going to lose their herpa. So they had sold, and it's cash, Craigslist breeders from all throughout Hampton Roads, all throughout the United States, are listing them as adoptables. And I've caught all of them and I'm told just try to turn them into Craigslist. So they're breeders that are saying, oh, well, I have this one and I'm adopting it out. They're all breeders. So he had posted on Craigslist, and because she's so unusual, rhino rat snakes are very unusual. Nobody called. I'm like the dork that just called because they wanted her to go to a home or an education foundation. They just didn't know how to get her there. You just don't walk up to a zoo like you used to in the old days. The tiger cubs at the Virginia Zoo here were found at a private home, and then they raised the funds to be able to get them an exhibit. So Penelope then went to this young man, who then went from the enlisted to the officer program, became a PA, and then worked down the hall for me. So when I called the ad, you hear Max on the phone. He recognized my voice, and he went, well, I'm sorry, ma'am. And I'm like, no, no, remember, Army, not that kind of captain. So he donated Penelope and all of the rest of their supplies to us. I said, yes, dear.
In relation to insurance purposes, are you working with a broker when you are allowing these animals to be adopted to...
There's absolutely no regulation or no insurance requirements on any of the animals we take in, which horrifies me. We have an insurance broker.
Like animal liability purposes, if you're you know, adopting out a snake and it bites someone, it's not something that a typical HO3 is going to cover. They are really...
Right, but there's absolutely no requirement in your home, which is horrifying, for any kinds of these animals. We don't... Anything that you can't legally adopt or you can't go to PetSmart and buy, we transfer to zoos.
But are you making a suggestion to...
Yeah, I have tons of insurance. Are you kidding?
Yeah,
I've got...
That's what she's asking.
Yeah, we have an insurance person that...
Not you. I'm saying when you're adopting them out to other homes...
There's no requirement.
But do you make a suggestion for it?
Yes.
Okay.
I can control as much as I can to a certain extent. So I can recommend things, and we do full setups. So all the reptiles come with a custom-built enclosure that looks like a slice of where they're from in the wild. The tanks are all live plants. They even have arthropods, sort of decomposing bugs, from the region where the animal's from that eats the poop. So they're easy to clean. They're low maintenance. That I make recommendations to people. I set up, I can require them as a part of their adoption to make an appointment for the animal within the first 2 weeks, and they have to have that before I even do the home visit and bring the animal to the veterinarian, who can then reinforce what I say. But I can't make them get special insurance because there is absolutely no law that says they have to. It's a big problem. There are hardly any laws governing size of pet trade. You can go to the convention center and for cash pay like $10 at the door and buy gaboons. You can buy any pit viper, monocled cobras. In the city of Virginia Beach, it's a loophole. It's legal to own venomous snakes in the city of Virginia Beach, an unlimited number. I know of homes that had 50 of them in one home.
I can guarantee that they're home.
Yeah, it was a grandson of old money family whom grandparents had died off, lived in the house, it's his now. So he had he'd gone to undergraduate school at William & Mary and on his own decided he was going to inject venom into himself to build a tolerance, almost lost his thumb. Did you have a question or you were stretching? Yes.
What's been your most productive fundraising technique?
Junior, anything attached to Junior. People lose their mind. So we had an open house for Halloween and we just put things out on a small, like women, children, family blogs. The weather was good that day. We had 400 people come through, 2,000 square feet. We had to meter them. People had to come back. So we thought it was a fluke. So then we did Christmas, but we were competing with Santa. So we had what for us was a good small event. We got enough donors that it was a good day. So we thought, great, we were right. The pandemonium of good weather of Halloween was the skew. No, it wasn't, Christmas was. Then we did Valentine's Day, and Junior's condition when I tap, he jumps up on a sofa or wherever I'm sitting. So we did 14 pictures with the Easter Bunny. I could have charged $100. Parents were at the door when we opened at 11 with children in complete outfits to have their picture taken with this rabbit to be basically the next picture that they sent to every family member. That was, we had to cut it off at 300 people. So now we do any events at the facility, you have to pay to get in the door. And we try and do something, we gave up low key, once a month at the facility, just low numbers. We don't want to have the animals stressed out.
Right.
We do free tours, and we're trying to have enough volunteer staff to soon be able to be open 7 days a week. But the weekends, it's a nut farm. Since the parade, it's been even crazier than it was before. There were people, as I was driving the bus, there were people grabbing their children, picking them up, like made for television movie, Not Without My Child, and grabbing and running with their kid like a sack of potatoes to just get a glimpse at him. And I'm in a bus that has a QR code on it and our telephone number is a foot long. We gave out, so this is the only, I don't believe in brochures, programming, if it's not digital. This to me, as someone who grew up in an environment where even the little unrecyclable grocery bags you get at Walmart for free, which amazes me, this represents dead trees. This, I can't get these on recycled paper. This is gloss ink. This, to me, is not a good thing. But it's the only way to get to the boomers because they're really not digital social media savvy yet. So we printed this up. So I was worried that people were going to drop them on the ground. People in groups were fighting each other. I had 10,000 of these printed up and we thought we'll use them for as long as we're at the location we're at. I'm down to half. It's been insane. This little postcard is the only actual printed brochure I'll ever do. Everything's on our webpage. So yeah, it's been a bit crazy.
Any other weird?
Oh, yes, Deb.
I don't know if it was actually 40 the birthday parties.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Junior's at every birthday party. We even close the facility. There are different time slots that you're allotted. We even close the facility so that the kids get the tour of any of the animals they want to see, and there's an educator, an intern, or a volunteer in each room so the kids can see whatever they want. Yes, Jen.
So what can Win Million Cups do for you?
Money. Hi, I need money, 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 money. There's no filter between my head. I was raised to be a son. So I honestly thought in the beginning people would just donate because I'm the crazy person that was willing to do the work. And I have retired 4 times. This will probably be the last one. We need large trustee donors. I have to get out of 2,000 square feet. We outgrew that building the second we opened our doors. I need people in their field to donate some of their time. I need offsets in a larger facility. I need a building that's in a safe neighborhood that I can get the top 10 economic wealth into in a neighborhood because I don't officially charge for a tour. So if you're low income, if we ever get a zoo that is a zoo, we're gonna use the model that the National Zoo did. We'll recoup on maps and parking. Because I didn't ever, growing up in an environment where people are literally starving to death, like when your dad said, you better finish the food on your plate because there are children starving in Africa, I played with them every day. I know starving children. So I wanted anyone from any economic environment to be able to come out and get exposure to these animals. That's why the bus has been so important to us. That I need to partner with ODU's pre-vet program, and if I can get a facility large enough, they can even have exotic classes at our facility. And there's enough information in my head. I know how to care for a chameleon with an eye infection now. I need partnerships of large places that can donate something as an offset to us because it costs them less money. I need an art gallery night and an adult event. We've done children's events, but I need to be in Mocha. I need Mocha?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
They really pronounce it Mocha?
Yeah.
I saw that and I was like, is that Mocha? I need to be in museums so that we can get awareness out. We did Joseph Simone, he had a gallery night, and it was mainly a social event. We need these paintings in homes of people who don't want to own a snake, but think it's hilarious that a tortoise painted something. So money.
So are you looking to move your location?
Yeah, the second we opened our tours, we already outgrew our facility.
Because it's too small, or
it's
way
too
small. Part of town.
No, it's completely safe. That's why we chose where it was.
Right.
We're on Jensen Drive, it's off Bird Neck, and it's a small little odd street. It's Owls Creek Commerce Center. It's right
in Virginia
past
Beach. I thought
yeah.
You said you were in Newport News.
No, I live in Newport News, sorry. We originally were in Newport News with Home Fosters, but then with the alligator episode is when we had to find a home. That we're in Virginia Beach. It's 1165. Jensen Drive, the address is on the coupon. Please take tons of coupons. I love that picture, Junior. Today is a new day, Chicken Little quote, has been one of our most popular chicken painting quotes. 1165 Jensen Drive, Virginia Beach, the address is on the coupon. I've got tons of them. Sign up for Junior's chocolate Easter Bunny Challenge, and you can take loads of them and give them to people. It's amazing when people come out of the facility, not just their reaction to Junior, but their reaction to all the animals. Some of them don't even realize there's a snake in a terrarium behind them, especially Penelope.
Well, thank you so much for coming. We've got a cup for your future.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I'm amped up enough as it is. Where is my kid? If you guys want to pet him and stuff, where is my kid?